Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Hong Kong UST to attend the UC RUSAL President's Forum. I'm Henry Tai, the director of the HKUST Jockey Club Institute for Advanced Study. I would like to extend our warmest welcome to our speaker today, Mr. Chuanzhi Liu. Sorry.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology UC RUSAL President's Forum. I am the director of the HKUST Jockey Club Institute for Advanced Study, Henry Tai. On behalf of the university, I would like to welcome the chairman of Legend Holdings Corporation and founder and honorary chairman of Lenovo, Mr. Chuanzhi Liu. Welcome. Today's forum will be conducted in Putonghua. First, I would like to introduce the UC RUSAL President's Forum and Mr. Chuanzhi Liu in English.
Today's forum will be conducted in Putonghua, while simultaneous translation to English is available. So for those of you who need it, I assume you have it already. To begin with, please allow me to briefly talk about the objective of the forum. The UC RUSAL President's Forum is organized by Hong Kong UST Jockey Club Institute for Advanced Study and hosted by our president, Professor Tony Chan. It is a major component of a five-year education and research collaboration with UC RUSAL and Hong Kong UST, which started in 2011. The collaboration aims to promote cooperation between Russia and Hong Kong and foster joint scientific research. The IAS of HKUST is a community of eminent scholars actively engaged in frontier research in high-impact areas. Through the President's Forum, IAS brings these scholars and distinguished community leaders to closer to our faculty and students to share their success stories and discuss the latest trend in science, technology, business, as well as other topical interest. Now, let me introduce our guest speaker. Mr. Chuanzhi Liu was born in Shanghai and raised in Beijing. He went to Xi'an to pursue his studies and graduated from the current Xi'an Dianzi Keji Dashe. At that time, it was a different name, but today that's what it's called. In 1966, during the Cultural Revolution, he was assigned to work in the Institute of Computer Technology of the Chinese Academy of Science in 1971. China started to open its economy in 1978, and Mr. Liu started a company with only 200K yuan and from the Institute and other like 10 researchers in 1984. And this is where the legend began. As the company grew, Mr. Liu aimed high. He wished to create China's own brand of computers to compete with the products from the West. He was a pioneer in successfully developing a Chinese approach to the commercialization of technology. And I'm pretty sure that everybody's familiar with his spectacular success, otherwise you won't be here. But still, I want to mention one other thing is that he's the first Chinese CEO to take over an American company. Essentially, in 2005, they took over the IBM PC division. Lenovo set a valuable example for other Chinese companies as well. wanting to go global. And after the financial crisis in 2007 and 2008, Mr. Liu helped the company to get through the most difficult period and then turn the business around. Under his leadership, Lenovo returned to profitability in the second half of 2009. And he was named one of China's most powerful people by Business Week in that year. In 2011, he retired as Lenovo's chairman and began to focus on the new business of Lenovo's parent, Legend Holdings, which is now a global conglomerate in both industries and investment. So, Mr. Liu holds many titles over the past years, among them a former delegate to the National Congress of Chinese Communist Party, delegate to National People's Congress of China, and many other civic duties, which is a very long list. But in 2010, let me just mention one, Mr. Liu won the Entrepreneur for the World Award at the World Entrepreneur Forum. So today's forum will be divided into three parts. First, Mr. Liu will give a talk on the growth of China's manufacturers, talking about Legend. Then Professor Tony Chen, our president, will conduct a dialogue with Mr. Liu. After dialogue, we'll invite questions from the floor.
There are three sessions in today's forum. First, Mr. Chuanzhi Liu will give a talk on the growth of China's manufacturers, talking about Legend, and share with us his path to entrepreneurship. The second session is a dialogue between the president of the university, Professor Tony Chen, and Mr. Liu. The final session will invite questions from the floor. Now, may I welcome Mr. Liu. I think it's more appropriate for me to stand up to greet the president of the university. Mr. President, teachers, students, and friends, I'll sit down after I've greeted everyone. Today I am. Is my mic working? Can you hear me in the back? I'm going to speak Putonghua today. If after using Putonghua today and the result is not satisfactory, I'll go back and quickly learn English. I'm going to work at using English to speak to everyone here in 10 years. Since today's forum is topic-oriented, I chose this topic, the growth of China's manufacturers. As we all know, China is a big manufacturing nation, but not a strong manufacturing powerhouse. However, how did China transition from a weak and small manufacturing country into a big manufacturing nation? This history is worth studying. Only when a thorough study of this history has been conducted can it become possible for China to truly become a strong manufacturing powerhouse. And that's the reason why I'm going to use Legend as an example to talk about the experiences of the growth of China's manufacturers. As Legend is going to be used as an example, I would like to first of all provide an overview of Legend. This small house was the place where we founded the company in 1984. It was inside this small house that I, together with 10 colleagues from the Institute of Computer Technology at the Chinese Academy of Science, that we founded the company. I was a scientist and engineer at the Chinese Academy of Science at that time, and I specialized in using magnetic recording for data storage. The next slide is about the present Legend. Legend currently has over 62,000 employees, and over 8,300 of them are international employees. Its assets are approximately over 180 billion. While the revenues are about 220 billion, the company maybe ranks about 340 in the Fortune 500 list. It's considered a medium-large company. That's briefly the current situation. The Chinese name Lianxiang is present twice on the slide. In China, it is necessary to distinguish the two names. My current position is in the blue highlighted area. I'm the chairman of Legend Holdings Corporation, but Chinese people are more familiar with Lenovo, which is in the lower left side of the chart. Lenovo is a subsidiary of Legend Holdings, and Lenovo's main business is computers. The subsidiary company is Lenovo. When I give our business card with the name Lenovo to an international person, then they know who you are. But it has the name Legend, which is at the very top of the chart, and they're not really familiar with this company. Today, I'll mainly talk about the Lenovo story. After Lenovo, we're working at familiarizing people with Legend Holdings and to be officially listed. When I left the Chinese Academy of Science to go into business, China had a planned economy. Planned economy virtually had no enterprises. The so-called enterprises at the time were in fact Chinese factories. So, who could I learn from? What should be done? There were no books available. The best way to learn was to become an agent of overseas companies. By being an agent, I learned and understood what is a market, what's the difference between sales and market, and how to manage finances and so forth. Being an agent is actually our learning process. We have served as agents to many companies. The companies we served as agents, and as long as we're serious in what we did, all these companies became big agencies in China. Among them, I think the one that might have affected me the most and had become my best teacher was Hewlett-Packard. I had put in a lot of efforts working for HP and had learned a great deal. After being an agent for a few years and achieved a certain degree of familiarity, of course, I assisted a vision and a hope as to whether we could establish our own brand. Since I came from the Institute of Computer Technology at the Chinese Academy of Science, I felt that we definitely had a certain understanding of technology. How did we develop our own brand? After serving as an agent and understanding the market, I knew what my clients wanted and started to prepare machines under my own brand. You can see that there's a circle on the screen and there's the word Legend in the circle. Lianxiang was called Legend then. What's that? It's a Chinese character system and it's called a Chinese card. Computers did not have Chinese characters. Everything was in English. Now, how did a Chinese person able to use such an English-only system? So our company developed this product, which is called Lianxiang Style Chinese Character System. It's a card plus software. After the card is inserted, it will have Chinese character capability. Why did we choose Lianxiang, these two Chinese characters? That's because the system also had an associative ability. For example, when we type the Chinese character Zhong or middle in English, words like Zhongguo, China, or Zhongyang will automatically appear on the screen. Who invented this? We did. Regrettably, we did not apply for a patent. It's really very unfortunate. Please go back to the other screen as I haven't finished. With this Chinese character system, it dramatically enhanced our sales promotion. Selling the same machine but with a Chinese card also means increase in sales. This is therefore our learning process, and we had also accumulated funds in those few years. When we sold the products, we accumulated funds, we accumulated experiences, and we also knew how to manage. Thus equipping ourselves with the capability to have our own brand. But having a brand to call our own was very difficult at that time. The difficulties are unimaginable for all of you here. I believe even for those of you from mainland China, it's hard to imagine. Why was it so difficult? As China's economy in that era is called the planned economy era. What is meant by that? It means I have the ability to manufacture computers, but in order to actually produce computers, I must have received a production license before I can start production. Otherwise, China will prohibit production. Even if you're willing to use your money, it's still no. The boss of our company was the Chinese Academy of Science. The vice president of the academy went to what was called the Ministry of Electronics Industry to apply for a component company to start manufacturing computers. A leader from the ministry replied and said, that's not possible. Why not? That's because China had already brought in over 80 production lines and they all lost money. So why would they allow another line just for us? Just one sentence from the ministry and everything came to a halt. Now what? Since I had already set a goal in mind, I would not have left any stone unturned. I must accomplish this goal. Then I thought of Hong Kong. At the academy, we tried everything and managed to obtain 4 multiple entry and exit permits into and out of Hong Kong. We brought $300,000 and collaborated with 2 Hong Kong companies. Each company contributed $300,000 and we established Lenovo Hong Kong. So the company in Beijing was not called Lenovo. It was the Hong Kong company that first used the Lenovo name. The company in Beijing was called Beijing Academy of Science Computing Company. Then it invested in the Hong Kong company. The company in Hong Kong could manufacture freely. Then in 1987, we purchased a 1,000 square feet property in Taiwan together with a warehouse and used that as our production plant. There were a total of 22 workers and handling personnel stationed there. That's where we started. What did we produce then? We produced motherboards. Where did we take the finished products to? We took them to Las Vegas and exhibited in the annual computer products show. The first time I went to Vegas, I don't remember whether it was 1989 or 1988. I had never seen a show that huge with exhibits one after another. But there were no Chinese there. I did not see any Chinese in the whole venue. Finally, I saw a group of Chinese electronics delegation who was sent by the Chinese government. The delegation was there to observe and study. As the delegation was walking around in the show, they unexpectedly found a Chinese company, a Hong Kong company, and the people from this company spoke mainland Chinese Putonghua. Then they asked, where are you from? We told them where we're from. They asked us how much we could sell. We told them we could sell approximately over $2,000 of motherboards, and that was an amazing accomplishment. The Chinese government heard of that and was very pleased. Then they gave us the production license. That's how we established our brand. So we learned in Taiwan that when you need to purchase a factory building in Taiwan, you have to hire a feng shui master to inspect the place. After the feng shui master inspected the place, he advised us what room to store our belongings and how tall the office desk needed to be. He said that if we followed what he said exactly, but didn't make money in the first year, we could go and destroy his brand. We did make lots of money in the first year, so when we kept moving, we kept hiring him. So the fee of the feng shui master continued to get higher and higher. Later, we learned that when you moved in Hong Kong or to collect rent, you needed to worship the gods. These are all the things I learned then. Then we have our own brand. What I would like to talk to you next is, in China in the 90s, the Chinese government would like to protect domestic industries. But then they were also aware that computer is a strategic product. So China should have their very own computer products. How could we be successful when we compete with non-Chinese people? They thought of a way to protect Chinese products, and that is to prohibit the import of overseas products. That way, Chinese products would be successful, so they used licensing. Imported computers had to be licensed, and the tariff was extremely high. How high? Exceeded 200%. That way, overseas computers would not be able to enter the Chinese market. Who would have guessed the results of imposing such a protection was Chinese computers were inferior in quality but with high prices, even higher than overseas computers. This greatly impacted the informatization of different industries. Then the government realized that computers were not household items. They were production tools. So the government first eliminated licensing in the computer industry and lowered the tariff. This means what we should say is the computer industry was the first to join WTO. That's how we unilaterally joined. Licensing was eliminated and the tariff continuously reduced. At around 1993, the custom tariff was reduced to about 20%. At that time, overseas computers entered the Chinese market in massive quantity. Thus, informatization in China substantially increased. Places like banks and hotels all use computers today. The increase was several fold. But what happened was really a sudden fatal blow to us computer manufacturers. The biggest computer company in China was called the Great Wall. It was invested by the Chinese government. And this company was a vice ministerial level company. The Chinese government invested several hundred millions or several tens of billions in this company. In the year when our investment was 200,000 RMB, theirs was 100 times or several hundred times. The Chinese government was very serious about investing in this big company, hoping to turn into a major supplier in China. But Great Wall collapsed within a year in 1993. The brand name of Great Wall Computer was Great Wall 0520. Why did it collapse? Because it didn't know how to sell, it didn't know how to defend against attacks from overseas companies. If I say Lenovo was like a night boat and big overseas enterprises were like warships at that time, it's no exaggeration. The tonnage, there's a thousand or tens of thousand times difference when it came to capital, technology, management and other aspects. What should we do under those circumstances? My colleagues and I held meetings to discuss this issue. One option was, since we truly would not win in this fight, we might as well step back and be an agent for other companies again. Another option was to insist on continuing our own brand. But if we continue with our own brand, can we make it? Fortunately, at that time, what we focused more on was not how big a difference we had with the other companies. What we put more consideration into was our problems that had existed a long time ago. As we search for the problems, we compare ourselves with ourselves, we discover a lot of problems. At that time, the computer industry had a relatively high gross profit margin. The gross profit margin of Chinese computer brands was about 27 to 28%. Today, the gross profit margin is 11 to 12%. It was 27 to 28% at that time. How much was ours? Our costs and expenses had already occupied 27%. There was a huge wastage. There were really lots of management problems. So I categorized each and every problem. Then we thoroughly restructured our company. We made massive adjustments and changes in the organizational framework and in our business model. We chose a 29-year-old young man, Yuan Qingyang, to be the general manager of the business department. From then on, miracles really did happen, as depicted in this chart. Our market shares in the Chinese market became bigger and bigger. Not only did we occupy a 27.5% market share in 2001, this didn't only happen in China, it also happened in Asia. What were our secrets? How did we do it? What did we do? There were extensive factors involved. Not the next slide yet. I'm going to talk about a major factor here, and that is we've conducted an in-depth analysis of the industry and we operated accordingly. What is meant by in-depth analysis? First of all, is cost. Computer cost and, say, cosmetics cost. What's the difference between the two? For cosmetics, the main cost is on marketing. Cosmetics itself, the raw material is not expensive. For computers, the parts, for example, CPU, memory chips, the screen, the hard disk, etc., made up 86% of the cost and expenses. Other factors, such as production, human resources, and sales, only occupied 40%. What I just told you was the situation in 1996. And what's the secret of success when it comes to cost? As we all know, if you would like to give someone a computer, you have to do it as soon as the computer is purchased. If you wait 6 months, the computer is not worth anything. Why is that? It's because prices of parts keep going down. new technologies have emerged. According to Moore's law, the new generation of memory chips comes out every 18 months. New technologies keep emerging. Old things will be eliminated. Therefore, the prices of parts will suddenly decrease. So the length of your inventory cycle is a deciding factor of how high or low your cost is going to be. I will cite you an example. As soon as I do, you'll understand what I meant. In 1996, what I'm telling you are all real figures. In July of 96, the memory chips inside computer was roughly $16 and 40 cents US dollars per chip. The price was suddenly reduced in July. When September came, the chip was about $2 each. There was such a drastic change. Why? With the launching of new memory chips, the old chips would require immediate disposition. So, if we did pay 16 some odd dollars for a single chip to be used in a computer, and if, say, we sell the computer after more than 3 months, this compares with purchasing the chips at $2 each in September, and the computer is also sold. Just this one item, with 8 chips in a motherboard, think about it. There's already a price difference of over $100. This is just one single item alone. The same holds true for the hard disk and screen at the same time as well. Therefore, the best practice is to shorten the inventory cycle of parts that can suffer sudden price reduction and make the cycle as short as possible. What we now know is to use the ERP method to have a good grasp of our inventory. But there was no such method at the time. What should we do then? We figured out a series of primitive methods. For example, what items should be ordered in small amounts for fast consumption? We researched and came up with 10 methods. What we did immediately reduced cost tremendously. From 1996 to 1997, in just 1 year, the prices of our brand of computers had continuously reduced 4 to 5 times. When newspapers reported the price reduction, they thought that we need to jump off buildings, selling our products at great loss. Actually, it wasn't like this. We already had a hold of the secret. By the end of the year, we not only had lots of computers sold, our profits were also unprecedentedly good. So issues like this require detailed analysis. Maybe our international counterparts understood. I don't know whether they understood or not at the time. But since their headquarters were not in China, so when changes happened in China, they were not able to handle the situation in a timely manner. We were not that big, nor did we attract attention at that time, so we suddenly rose. As for our Chinese counterparts, they had not figured out what's going on yet. Let me cite you an example. There are lots of things each and every industry can study. At that time, as we had improvements in running our computer operations, the Chinese government and the Chinese people had great hopes on us and hoped that we could compare our core technologies with non-Chinese. I felt that if we made such a comparison, then we're done. The Chinese government did not provide us with any funding, and we went ahead with the comparison. The R&D cost of CPU was humongous. If we began the process incorrectly, then we're history. At that time, we repeatedly studied the functions of the technology. We had to maximize the usage of mature technologies. Let's just pick an example at random. In 1998, using a computer to go on the internet had become very popular. Everyone wanted to go online. After our study, we actually discovered that unless you're a fan, otherwise there were not many people who went online. Why is that? That's because it was very difficult to go online. When you brought a computer back after the purchase, you needed to turn it on, insert the modem card, and install the software by yourself. Even more troublesome was you need to register with the telecommunications department, as you would be using a telephone line to go online, so you needed to go to register, making it very troublesome. but for us, as we're a company, so there's something we were able to accomplish. So we launched a kind of computer called the Angel Computer into the market. We promoted the computer's capability of one key online, that is, you only need to press one button and voila, you're online. We also stocked enough products and were able to display the computers in 300 Chinese cities at the same time, so our market share in that year had greatly increased. And we kept working on developing various technologies, including one key to recovery. That is, if there were problems with the computer system, just press one key and the computer would recover. Before we had the ability to conduct R&D in core technologies, we were able to maximize the usage of mature technologies according to market needs. And that's very important. I had only cited two examples. There are actually lots and lots of examples to help us achieve our position in the market. For example, when it came to financing, what could we do to provide loans to our channels while guaranteeing that we had the least amount of bad debts? All these things deserve research into. We have conducted careful researches on these topics to allow us to have achieved such results. But the 27.5% market share of 2001 continued to decrease after 2001. It was reduced to about 24% in 2003. What were the reasons behind it? It's because there came a more ferocious competitor, and that was Dell from the United States. Dell created a new business model, and I'm not going to explain in detail this business model here. They went from the United States to Europe, and no one could defeat them. At that time, Compaq was the biggest company for many years, and Dell defeated Compaq in the United States in 2 to 3 years. Then Dell entered the Chinese market. After Dell entered China, initially they dealt with big businesses which had nothing to do with us. As they started to deal with medium and small enterprises, it was then that Dell started to have an impact on us. They forcefully took our business. We fought with them continuously for 3 years. In the first 2 years, we did lose, but we went ahead to acquire a detailed knowledge of them and conducted analysis. We then created a newer business model, a dual model. So in 2004, we finally won against Dell. Since then, Dell was never able to recover, and it is forever behind Lenovo. When it came to our war against them, it was an important year for us. A significant event happened in that year. Next. Okay, I'm not going to talk about this significant event for now. I'm going to follow the order in my presentation. Lenovo, while studying the rules of the industry, we also worked hard at studying the basic rules of running a company. While industries have their own rules, there are some common rules in running a company. The first rule is not a management issue, it's a mechanism issue. Whether it's a state-owned enterprise or private enterprise is a mechanism issue, and this is very important. We conducted our research on this basis and came up with what we call the three key elements of management. The first one is management team building. Does management really see eye to eye? Is this a capable management team? Do they have the same core values? The orders that the management give, do people in the company listen and follow? It's very important that the team sees eye to eye. This is called team building. And that's the content of our research. What does the team do? The first thing is, of course, to study the company's development strategies. What is the profit model? How to make money? What you do today? What are the risks tomorrow? What directions do you consider? A strategy issue. This is the second element. We have a strategic topic method. How do you consider basic issues? The third element is to lead your team. Even with a good management team and good strategies, do your employees like to work? Our conclusion in leading the team, using our own words, is how to make your warriors love fighting wars. How to make your warriors capable of fighting wars. This idea translated to our situation means how to make your employees love the company, love the work. Why would they love the company? Why should they go to work? Then how do they go about working? The third thing is after forming a team and with organization to become efficient. That's what we call leading the team. Combine all these and we call them the three key elements of management. These are not the main contents of today, but they play a very important role in later developments. That's one thing that we did. Another thing that's also very important is when the Legend brand came out, when I left the academy, the 200,000 RMB was invested by the Institute of Computer Technology. Therefore, we should say at that time, it's a 100% state-owned enterprise. Why did I found this enterprise? I was a scientist and engineer at the Academy of Science. I was involved in performing experiments, looking at results, and writing papers. At that time, I felt that I was held back. I'm not sure if the Chinese term that I used was accurately interpreted. In other words, I felt that I wasn't able to fully use my abilities. So when I had the opportunity to found my own company, in lots of companies that specialize in science, it was the president who mobilized the scientists and hoping that the scientists could leave and bring their scientific and technology achievements with them to found company. I was the only one who insisted on leaving on my own. I was not mobilized by them. At that time, I was not after anything higher, anything more grand, or anything more lofty, nothing like that. I only wanted to give the values of life a try. I felt that I had certain level abilities, I just wanted to see how capable I could be. So when I first came out, I considered administrative powers very important. When I negotiated with the director, he talked about 200,000 yuan. I said that was fine, but I said that required three powers. The first one was the power over personnel administration. Don't arrange personnel for me, I'm going to do it that myself. I'll have the management team do that. The second one was the power over financial control. After we paid taxes, after money was paid to the institute, I would be responsible for where and what to invest in with the remaining funds. This would be our responsibility and not just I. But the institute could not interfere. The third one was the lead decision. The institute could not interfere about leads and things like that. The institute agreed to all of them because it was just 200,000 yuan and not a lot of money. If some problems arose, it could bring trouble to director, so they would gladly give you the powers. If you ask for those powers today after the company have become bigger, it's definitely going to be very difficult. So if you want to ask for power, make sure you ask when the company is small. So what does this illustrate? It shows that I consider management powers as very important. When I engage in the actual work, you could see that I only touch this subject very lightly. This is nothing but a story. There were always extremely desperate matters we needed to handle every year. It's very hard to overcome all the difficulties. Next time I'll share these stories with you, those difficult stories, those extremely desperate stories. But after overcoming these desperate incidents, I would think of the friends from Hong Kong who collaborated with me, these shareholders, board members, and general managers. This is like setting sail. After we went through violent storms and waves, we successfully arrived ashore on the other side. When the business made profits, Hong Kong people had a share. We were nothing but the captain of the ship. We got the pay and everything else had nothing to do with us. Actually, the ones who controlled the rudder, the ones facing the greatest risk were us. Of course, we felt that if it continued this way for long periods of time, it's not fair to us. Therefore, in 1993, I talked to Guangzhou Zhou, the president of the Chinese Academy of Science at the time, who later became a vice chairman of National People's Congress about this issue. I believe that this company was founded by the academy, and all presidents of the academy were very open-minded, like open-minded mother-in-laws. If I were a daughter-in-law, then he were the open-minded mother-in-law. Easy to talk to. The mother-in-law immediately understood what's going on, and he said that the founders and scientists and engineers of technology companies should have shares, but he said that there's nothing he could do. At that time, China had a bureau called the Administrative Bureau of State-Owned Property, and it was then that would decide whether to give any shares to you. There was nothing I could do, but we could talk. If you couldn't give us shares, you could give us profits. As you're a shareholder, you could allocate some of the annual profit as bonuses to us. That's easy to do. Therefore, the academy allocated 35% of the annual profit as bonuses to employees. So, my colleagues and I enjoyed 35% of the profit. But I did not distribute the money to anyone. I kept the money in the company to continue the company's operation. But in the books, is recorded that the money belonged to us. In 2001, Mr. Lan Qingli, a political leader of China and a member of the Standing Committee of the Politburo, like one of the seven leaders now, when he was responsible for science and technology, he proposed that high-tech companies in China must have a shareholder system. Lenovo should be one of those companies. Then after undergoing some complicated work, we used the 35% profit we saved up all these years to purchase 35% of the company's shares. So people kept talking about national assets companies, but we purchased the shares with cash. That makes it easy for us to voice our opinions. So, the Academy had 65% of the shares, and I, on behalf of the employees, had 35% of the shares. This indeed played a pivotal role in the company's development. As the business expanded, we're in need of more young people who could expand the business and to lead the company in the front line. The colleagues who founded the company with me, the majority of them, is not the majority, rather all of them were scientists and engineers of the institute. As we continue our business, there were some difficulties when we came to leadership. But the path to founding the company was not easy, and now the company had money, it had profit, so if you dismiss them means income reduction for them. It's unreasonable and unfair to dismiss them. After they had acquired shares, then you could talk to them and said, we're all gardeners who founded this orchard. Now our orchard has become bigger and we should allow more capable gardeners to work here. In the future, when the apples ripe, we'll send the first harvest to your home. You don't have to work as gardener anymore. Just stay home and wait for the apples to be delivered. What do you think? They all thought that this was a good idea. That's the analogy they all agreed with. So they gave up their leadership role to the younger generation. Otherwise, the company would start to age, and there's not anything that could be done about it. Therefore, the transformation of the shareholding system is indeed very important. What I'm going to talk next is, I'll try to control the time to 40 minutes, and I'm not going to tell any more stories. And I'll try to be faster. In 2004, we did something huge, and that was we acquired IBM's PC division. The press conference was held on December 8. After the press conference, it brought great shock. When reporters heard that I purchased ThinkPad, they gave me applauses. Reporters who knew me well said, Mr. Liu, we gave you a big round of applause. We applauded because of your encouragement, but we don't believe that you succeed. He said that you did do this, bringing honors to the Chinese people. Even if you die or fail, it's still worth it. These are his exact words to me. Something even more laughable is, I went to Peking University Guanghua School of Management to give a talk at the EMBA class. There were two EMBA classes with about 90 people. As I start my talk, I asked them to raise a hand if they think the acquisition was a good thing. Of the 90-plus people there, three raised their hand, two raised their hand way up, and one didn't raise high. The two raised their hand way high were confirmed to be from Lenovo to attend this class, and one of them was hesitant. The one who didn't raise their hand high told me that even if I didn't raise my hand high, I'd still support you. That's very moving to me. But was the reality before and after the acquisition? As you can see, the yellow bars represent situation before the acquisition. In 2004, Lenovo's own revenue was $2.9 billion. That's before the acquisition. In 2012, Hammer Hill reported the revenue in 2013 to be approximately $37 billion, and you see the difference. When it comes to market share, we used to rank 7 or 8 in the world with a 2.4% market share. Now we were number 1 in the world with 18.5%. That's roughly how it went. So, what did we consider prior to the purchase? We consider the following issues. First, of course, is why did IBM want to sell this business? Simply put, there were losses. Why the losses? If IBM couldn't make it, can we make it? We did conduct in-depth studies to these questions. And what specifically are we purchasing from them? That's something that required looking into. The very thing we wanted to buy is the brand. the ThinkPad brand. Then we wanted to purchase the technologies. When it comes to technology, we're purchasing the people. There's a research center in Raleigh and another research center in Yamato, Japan. And how we match up the researchers there, researchers in China and so forth. As for internationalized resources, they refer to distribution channels, international employees, etc. These were the things that we wanted to purchase. Then what are the risks? The risks are these. The first risk is, of course, after you purchase the brand, a Chinese person owning the ThinkPad brand would think, is it still ThinkPad? Will people still trust you? The second risk is, when employees come to you, will they be willing to serve under you? Will they be willing to work? What if they leave? These are the issues. We have studied these two issues, and they were easy to resolve. The outcome was as what we expected. No major problems occurred. What was the biggest problem? The biggest problem was cultural adaptation. What is cultural adaptation? Everyone talks about cultural adaptation. According to statistics, there's approximately a 25% success rate of merging and acquisition in the computer industry in these years. The main problem comes from cultural adaptation. Cultural adaptation means people from different enterprises. For example, as we acquire the IBM business, people came from different countries. How are they going to work together? How do they collaborate with each other in their jobs? They each have their own habits, they each have their own thoughts. How can they work well together in their jobs? These are the truths behind cultural adaptation. As I've mentioned earlier, what's the biggest problem? Cultural adaptation is the biggest issue. Sure enough, since the acquisition, Lenovo has been performing extremely well. But then in 2008, with the occurrence of the financial crisis, major problems also happened. This slide depicted the time when the financial crisis happened. Between 2008 and 2009, Lenovo loss reached $260 million in one quarter, and it continued to suffer losses after that. This illustrates what happened after that. At that time, everyone thought that the problem was going to get worse. With no turning back, Lenovo had no choice but were forced to restructure its executive leadership team. Lenovo restructured its board of directors. I had retired a while back and was no longer the chairman of the board. But then I rejoined the company and became the chairman once again and worked with Yuan Qingyang, who was originally the chairman of the board. Then an overseas manager became the CEO. Originally, it was Yuan Qingyang and this new CEO worked with each other. Now is Yuan Qingyang and myself, and the result of our collaboration was very successful and the profit increased. Profits went from a negative territory to a positive territory. The next slide can better explain the situation. The dotted blue line on this graph shows the ups and downs of the computer industry in each year. The red line is us, Lenovo, and how we did. What are the characteristics of this graph? Please refer to what happened prior to restructuring, which is the left-hand side of the graph. The red line was always below the blue dotted line, which means our growth rate was always lower than the mean growth rate of the industry, and also lower than our few competitors. Please look at our major competitor, the light green line. Maybe it's Dell, or maybe it's HP. After the restructuring, we drastically exceeded the mean value, and there was a great gap between the two lines. In the next slide, you could see the winning areas. This is our recent situation, the fourth quarter of 2013. You could see the winning areas. That's the fourth quarter of 2013. That's here. You could see the growth rate in China was negative 7.3. It was a negative figure when it came to computers, while Lenovo was negative 6.1, which was a little bit better than the market. Please look at other areas. In Europe, it was negative 2.4, but it was a positive 13 at Lenovo. In the APAC and Latin American markets, the growth rate of Lenovo far exceeded the market's growth rate. This demonstrated that we didn't make money in China, but we made money in the world. The next thing is what people are more concerned about. How did we make a comeback? That's what I would like to talk about. In order to understand how we made a comeback, we need to understand why the loss happened in the first place. The financial crisis was the blasting fuse that led to the loss. What does it mean by the blasting fuse? There's a difference between a dynamite barrel and a blasting fuse. With the presence of a blasting fuse, then it's possible to ignite a dynamite barrel. Even without a blasting fuse, it's still possible to ignite a dynamite barrel. Therefore, even without the financial crisis, Lenovo still has serious problems. I felt that after the acquisition, there were problems with corporate management. At that time, I was a board member at Lenovo. Of course, I represent the major shareholders. I did not hold any post except as the chairman of the strategic committee. What were the problems with corporate management? There were several. I'm going to cite one example here. What was the problem with management? I felt that there were short-term behavioral issues with the management. For example, the CEO was an international person. When the person was hired to become the CEO, why was there a short-term behavioral issue? The CEO felt that if in his five-year tenure he was able to greatly increase Lenovo's revenues, profits, and stock prices, then the whole world would recognize him as the best CEO. This was because the world thought that it's not possible for a Chinese enterprise to be comparable with PC enterprises outside of China. Such excellent outcomes were the result of his leadership. With such ideas in mind, he would pay extra attention to profits, etc., and was unwilling to invest in issues that would definitely happen in the future and in the long run. For example, in 2005 and 2006, one of the biggest characteristics of the computer industry was the growth of consumer customers exceeded the growth of business customers. When it came to computer purchasing, the growth in the number of regular consumers purchasing computers was more than the growth in the number of agencies and enterprises purchasing computers. At that time, regular consumers all used computers. When Lenovo acquired IBM's PC division, IBM PCs used to be high-end computers only sold to businesses. That's also true in Europe, Latin America, and other countries. So you must open up a path for consumer PCs. And money must be spent. For what? Spending money to understand localized products, conduct marketing research, but spending even more money on IT system. Like what? Like what I said earlier on the ERP system, on the IT system. IT system is like the underground sewage system and so forth when repairing a building. It requires lots of money. This is something we cannot see, but we still need to spend money on it. How much money do we need? At that time, in 2006, when I did my research, I recall it was over $700 million. Where would this $700 million plus come from? It would come from our profits. Take some profit every year for this future investment. However, at that time, CEO Bill refused to put forth such investment because he wanted the profits to look pretty. Since he refused to put forth such investment, it's like digging a grave. Without the financial crisis, maybe it could be hidden, as there was no customer base. So when the financial crisis happened, the first thing business customers did was stop buying computers. The next thing was layoffs. As soon as they stopped purchasing computers, the situation immediately exploded. This, in reality, was somewhat related to mechanism. This gives the MBA course, especially posing an obvious question to the MBA course in the US. Whether there's a real owner in an enterprise is of great importance. Managers by profession will exhibit short-term behaviors under certain circumstances. This is actually not the content for discussion in today's forum. Then there was the cultural conflict. The so-called cultural conflict, what is it? Yang Qingye was the chairman of the board at the time. Yuan Qingyang was a bit younger than myself and not as experienced as myself. So he told the CEO that he should do something consumer related. The CEO disagreed. The chairman became anxious and said that he would organize the people and did the work himself. The CEO felt that this had interfered with his authority. So the CEO approached his US boss in the board of directors. At Lenovo's board of directors, we were the shareholders, and there were two other small shareholders as well. Both of them were major investment firms in the US. One was TPG and the other was GA. TPG already ran top 10 in the US, and the founder was there. The CEO wanted to go and talk to the founder. Yuan Qingya came to me to complain. The bad thing about this was it became the Chinese side versus the US side. With such a collision between the two sides, the company could not be saved. My participation as a chairman was to resolve this issue. What did I do? There were several things that I did. I assisted Yuan Qingyang to organize a Chinese and Western management team. There were both Chinese and non-Chinese in the team. They collaborated well with each other. Management was completely different than when the past CEO was present. Under the leadership of Yuan Qingyang, everyone would talk and understand everything before a decision was made and so forth. They used the ways we built our management team to lead. It was completely different than the old ways. I'm not going to talk about this in detail. The second thing was to formulate a correct and executable strategy. Since every member of the management team has a full right to speak, say what kind of strategy when it comes to market share in the offense, we don't only want market share, we also want profits in the defense and so forth. The duties and responsibilities of each person were clearly discussed, thus setting an executable strategy. Next. And I was directly responsible for an assignment, that is to assist this enterprise to establish a good corporate culture. First, there must be common values. For example, what do we as employees approve of? A Chinese company, no matter what the person's nationality is, what do we pursue? This means to be studied thoroughly. That's the thing I worked hard to help them to achieve. After these three things were completed, next, the company did in fact achieve success. After success came, we came up with a conclusion as to what we did right. Before the acquisition, we tried our best to think over the problems, like what I said earlier. Why did IBM want to sell the division? We worked at understanding the issues. The second thing was we felt that we had a good acquisition foundation. What's meant by good acquisition foundation? It means we're really familiar with the industry. For example, if we purchase a chemical company, what the CEO did, I would not be able to understand. Then how would I know what I should do? So it's something you're familiar with. That's what we refer to as having an acquisition foundation. The third thing was a common management foundation, and that's what I had mentioned earlier, to build up a management team, to set up the strategy, and to lead the team. Sure enough, it was very appropriate when manufacturing was concerned. Now, when we talk about non-Chinese employees leading the team, and international employees are still very proud to work for Lenovo. Why? Salary increases, good living. So, of course, they are proud. The fourth thing is to be good at learning. Here we talk about how capable Chinese were and how capable I was. Actually, there are lots of things other people are competent in that I haven't mentioned. There are things that other people have already established a process which we should seriously learn from. Finally, I think that the signs of a successful acquisition are not just the financial return, which makes it look appealing. Even more important is I haven't sent one Chinese to Europe, to the US, to Latin America to be the number one person, to be the leader. Not one Chinese was sent, but the strategy was completely the same. The culture was completely the same. This, I think, is truly the sign that we've become an international company. The end. Thank you. I was 10 minutes over. Thank you. Your seat is over there. That was a brilliant talk, isn't it? I have a suggestion. Considering how brilliant your presentation was, you should talk to our leaders in the business school and don't just give talks at places like Wanhua. Come to our business school and be a professor here, okay? Mr. President, I'm a person whose level is not high. You're too modest. No. I'm talking about my level of thinking is not high. My pursuit of happiness is I hope that when I get old, I hope to go play golf and chat with my friends. You can go play golf here, no problem. If your requirements are so simple, then no problem. I do believe that young people in Hong Kong are not very familiar with things in mainland China. I feel there is an obligation of mine to come and do a presentation here, but I don't want to hold any specific post. I've learned a lot. First, I used to think legend. Was it in Chinese, is Chuanzhi. You correct, it's Chuanzhi. I used to think that was your name. My Putonghua is not so good. So I thought it was your name. So now I know, right? For Lenovo, the loss of mobile phones with predictive typing. That's what it meant, right? Another thing is, I almost became a Lenovo employee. In my first job, IBM gave me an offer. If I decided to go work for IBM at that time, then I'll currently be a Lenovo employee, right? Oh my, I made the wrong decision then. If you did go and work for IBM, then I won't be sitting here today as you'll be the chairman of Lenovo. This company, Lenovo, is really a legend in Chinese society. Your company celebrates its 30th anniversary this year, right? 30 years almost. I almost met you when you founded the company in Beijing. The first time I went to the Chinese Academy of Science was in 1985. I remember it was in early December. At that time, I was visiting the University of Hong Kong, and the Chinese Academy of Science invited me to go there. Going to Beijing was no problem, but I didn't bring any winter clothes with me. I asked my father to lend me the thickest clothes that he had. I remember it was very, very cold. You know, people were wearing long feather clothing, down jacket. Even wearing that is not warm enough. So I decided not to go to Beijing in December. I have three questions that I would like to ask you. The first question is, Lenovo initially purchased IBM's PC division and later was also in the mobile phone business. What's going to happen in the future? Recently, there's some big news in Hong Kong that there are two alumni of our school who recently founded a company. And 2 to 3 weeks ago, a Chinese company poured funding into their company. The valuation is that the company has $350 million, and is for a mobile game in a mobile phone. This is something I'm not familiar with as I don't play these games. What's going to be the trend? What is Lenovo's thought on the mobile development? With the emergence of the mobile internet, with the emergence of the advanced information technology, lots of functions found in notebook are gradually transferred to a pad. A big mobile phone, I don't have my mobile phone with me, it's about the same size as a pad. It's about that size. Mine's a little bigger than yours. This way, a mobile phone can completely replace a notebook, and it also replaces the functions of a notebook. Mr. President, like you and myself, when we go on business trips, carrying a mobile phone is sufficient. It might not be sufficient for your secretary, because there might still be lots of things that require a keyboard and a different operating system. So Lenovo has started the overall arrangement a long time ago. Originally, there was a mobile manufacturer, then the overseas CEO sold the company. At that time, there was no mobile internet yet. After discussing with Yuan Qingyang, we felt that there is a possibility that wireless would be connected with a computer. So there was another investment company of ours called Honorary Capital, and it's very famous in China. It went ahead and purchased this company. After Yuan Qingyang became CEO, we sold the company back to Lenovo. Lenovo's mobile phones could rank pretty high in China and with high sales volumes in the world. We sold approximately more than 40 million mobile phones a year. What does this show? It shows that the risks in the high-tech industry are very high. When you eat a bowl of rice, you must keep an eye out on the rice in the cooker. You must know where the cooker is. Recently, we purchased Motorola, Yuan Qingyang, and they purchased Motorola. A major reason is Lenovo has more than enough computer patents. But there are not sufficient patents in the telecommunication field. If you want to sell mobile phones to Western developed countries, it's very difficult to do so without patents. So we purchased Motorola to resolve the patent issue, and we've spent a lot of money. That's roughly it. The second question is about branding and innovation. You said in your talk that the biggest reason you purchase IBM is for its branding. That's correct. I think the Lenovo name as a Chinese brand is the most well-known internationally. Now there are lots of brand names on the internet such as Alibaba. But I've heard lots of criticism from overseas about China, that China does not have enough international brands, not a lot. And innovation is also lacking. No matter whether it's Taobao or others, they all learn things from outside of China. It might not be a fair criticism, but what do you think that Chinese enterprises, especially in the technology field, can they create their own brand? What can be done so that they can do a better job? How to create a good brand? Does this have anything to do with innovation? There are two things about branding. One is to provide good products and services. The second thing is how to make people be aware of your brand. Even with good products and services, but if people are not aware of the brand, that's not a brand. If you only focus on promotion, and we say in Chinese, be deceitful, and provide low-quality products and services, then it's also useless. So the two have to be combined as one. The two innovations involved if you want to provide good high-tech products, including innovation in product technology and innovation in business model. In China, it's not just technological innovation. Corporate management and business model, etc., cannot impede technological innovation to be effective. What does that mean? There are lots of good results at universities and science academies. How come enterprises cannot turn these results into products? A short while back, President Xi Jinping brought all members of the Politburo to Zhonghuanzun or ZOL to see an exhibition. I was at the Lenovo exhibit. I gave him a suggestion. After the suggestion, everyone from different enterprises who were present all gave me a round of applause. What suggestion did I propose? I told him that China has a program called Thousands Talents Program, and you're aware of it, right? Of course I do. Every year, think about it, no matter how talented a scientist is, when they get to China, whether they can be successful or not, does not completely depend on how good the results of their research is. It depends on whether it's a good enterprise. All of you can think about what I said to see if it makes sense. No matter how excellent the result of the work is, if it gets into the hands of a horrible enterprise, then it's not going to work. Therefore, if political leaders of China do not pay attention to the role entrepreneurs play, do not pay attention to the management mechanism for enterprises, are not concerned with studying these issues, it will be difficult for results of scientific researchers to be realized. Looking down on business people has been a habit of the past in China, so I think how do you combine the scientific research portion with a good enterprise portion into one is something the Chinese government should seriously put thoughts into. My last question is related to this. We are now at HKUST. Lots of people in our audience are our students, and they might be future Lenovo's employees or future international leaders. What advice would you like to give to our students? The results of the scientific research they conducted at the university and things they have learned. What kind of aspirations can they have and what can they do? Can you give them some advice, please? Let me first ask the question. After you graduate, let's assume there are two paths you can choose. One is to found your own company. The other is to work for a major company with a good offer. Which path would you choose? If you'd like to found your own company, please raise your hand. Let me see. Be truthful, okay? Okay, please put your hand down. How many of you are willing to accept a good offer? Please raise your hand. Actually, every good student getting good grades at the university, whether you can perform well at work and fulfill your expectation. This is something a really smart student should consider. When China opened up in 1978-1977, the University of Science and Technology of China accepted a 13-year-old student. His name is Borning or something like that. I don't remember exactly the first case of the special class for the gifted young. Later, the student absolutely refused to associate with anyone and was very close-minded. Later, he had depression. Now I know he became a Buddhist monk. Of course, an eminent monk. This is a true story. There are students who have great achievements in different things. Therefore, when a person designs his future path, think clearly what you want to do. Of course, you need to be able to meet the requirements as well. Then you have to keep going and be persistent in the pursuit. Many people only go halfway and quit. For example, founding your own company, you must think carefully about founding your own company. You're going to have to fight your way through, and it's going to be a tough road ahead. If you accept a good offer, it's much better when it comes to social status and financial position. For example, if I work for Goldman Sachs as a managing director, it's an honor. But if you found your own company, it's a small company, it appears that you have a lower social status when compared with other people, and you have to work very much harder than other people. But remember, if you found your own company, your 1 year might equal to 10 years of people accept a good job offer. Why is that? Because you have to consider how your employees are going to live. Things you need to consider are much more. Therefore, even if you fail in your pursuit of founding your own company and go to work for somewhere else, you might do a better job. You've learned things. So it's hard to say which one is advantageous. Anyway, when you're at school, consider what you would like to do and pursue it. Not only do you learn specific knowledge from books, you must also hone yourself in life. I think that's pretty important. Very good. I was impressed with something you said earlier. You said that you found a legend in 1984. You said that you weren't going for any ideals. You just wanted to see how far your abilities could go. I think that's very important to your own confidence. Even if you might fail, you're still going to give it a try, is that right? But there's something that I'm pretty good at. And that is, after I've proven myself, I kept raising the bars I set for myself. Later, I set the goal to create a Chinese computer brand. It sounds easy today, but at the time, it was unimaginable because the technological level of Chinese computers compared with overseas computers trailed way, way behind. But with hard work, we made it. Then we wanted to be number one in China, thus setting a higher goal. A person needs to continuously raise their goals. What can this be called? Humans can be divided into two categories. One type wants to become a big tree, and the other type is willing to be a small grass. What's the difference between a small grass and a big tree? A small grass can have a quieter life. I can treat my wife and my children better. That's very normal, very good. Society needs tranquility. Through work, this is quite correct. There are people who want to be a big tree. They're born to be a big tree. They will encounter different kinds of difficulties and even more troublesome events. Of the 10 people who want to be a big tree, only one will be successful, but they keep pursuing. What is interesting is society is able to move forward, and that's because it's being led by people who want to be a big tree. If there were no people like Deng Xiaoping in China to transform China from a class struggle country into one that develops its economy and to become a tree, it's completely impossible for China to be successful. Therefore, people should have lofty aspirations and work hard at pursuing these aspirations. I think these are people society welcomes and needs the most. Thank you.
Okay.
It's Q&A session. I have several rules. One is, if you want to ask a question, please wait for the mic. The second one is, tell us your name and what do you do at our school or outside of the school. The third one is, be short and quick. Don't make a speech, okay? Are you going to pick, or am I? I'm going to pick some young students. Are you a student? Yeah. How are you? I'm Xiaoyi Zhao, and I'm an exchange student, major in engineering. I came from the National University of Singapore. What I would like to ask you is, in your speech, you mentioned a corporation Dell, but you haven't mentioned Apple. I would like to ask you the impact of Apple's development on Lenovo and Lenovo's responding strategies. Also, when we mention Dell, we will think of pricing. When we mention Apple, we will think of their core technology. I would like to ask about Lenovo's core technology. What does Lenovo use to compete with them? When I was in charge of Lenovo in the 90s, Apple was still very small. When Apple was able to pose as a threat, it was in 2011 when Lenovo's business had completely recovered back to normal. I made an important decision. I resigned my post as the chairman of the board. I also made another even more important decision. I sold 8% of the Legend Holdings equity to the management team headed by Yuan Qingyang at a discount price. The sale at that time provided a great deal of support to them because when I was the chairman of the board, I fully understood how high the profits is going to be each year. Stock prices would keep going up. Why did I give them a discounted price? That is to encourage them to become the owner of the enterprise. Even though we're still a major shareholder with 40% of the shares, I also gave up being a director and left the board so that other people can become directors. Why did I do that? It is because I have new businesses that I need to develop. If I don't spend efforts to investigate Lenovo, like problems with Apple as mentioned earlier, if I continue to stay in the board, even just as a director, my guess is if Yuan Qingyang has to make a decision, he can't help but turn his head and look at me. If I haven't put in any efforts, that's not good. So I insisted on leaving this area. Therefore, how to treat Apple and how to compete with them, I believe that Yuan Qingyang would have an idea in mind. He comes to me and tells me once a month, and I'm not going to speak for him. I'll definitely introduce him to come here and talk to you. You can ask him then. The gentleman in blue, please.
Okay.
Mr. Chuanzhi Liu, thanks for your talk. My name is Min Yu Chu. I came from Shantung and I'm a first-year student at HKUST. I can say that I've been a Lenovo Group's follower and fan since I was little. I've always used your products from Legend to Lenovo. In one of your PPT, you introduced the structure of Legend Holdings and the subsidiary companies under Legend Holdings. You specifically talk about Lenovo and not the other subsidiaries. A few days ago, I read on the internet about an interview at the China Development Forum. You introduced the Joyville Group, a subsidiary of Legend Holdings, about investment on agricultural products. As you know, Legend Holdings don't only involve in PC manufacturing, they also include areas such as agriculture, IT, and real estate. My first question is, what is the industrial development and important strategies of Legend Holdings in the future? Are there any priorities? The second question is, and this year is something that we're concerned about, and that is the public listing issue of the parent company of Lenovo. Initially, it stated that it will be listed as H share. Now, whether it will be listed as A share, will you be able to disclose more information to us? Yes, thank you. A first-year student, won't you agree that our students are excellent, a first-year student? He is really very familiar with Legend and Lenovo. He has done in-depth studies. I'm going to talk about strategic development first. China, in the future, In these few years, through the third plenary session of the 18th CPC Central Committee, the business committee, including myself, generally believe that there will be lots of setbacks. But there's a possibility that the trend is going to be very good. What's going to happen when it's very good? There's a possibility that it will be very beneficial for consumption-driven GDP's cash. If it's a consumption-driven economy, then it's a virtuous cycle in the economy. There are huge demands in China. If the government can more effectively use the taxes collected on the general public to allow the poor to have more money to spend and to reserve farmers' issues and so forth, then our future development will be focused on consumption, consumption services and financial services. If the focus is on these areas, the impact of international economy will be small, small influence by high-tech products, and the effect of government policies is relatively smaller. And then, another thing is, enterprises that have a greater risk will let go and they go fight. We also have some more stable territories, and that's this one. Therefore, we seriously researched the possibility of agribusiness a few years ago. When people heard that legend will be in the agribusiness, is this a joke? No, it's not. It's a result of serious researches. Agriculture is, in fact, a very big market in China. On the surface, it looks like agriculture is being subsidized by the Chinese government. In reality, there are two areas that produce a large profit margin. One is, in the past, lands were distributed to the farmers. For example, a farmer would get several acres of land, and in Shandong, each family would get about an acre. That was briefly the situation. It's not possible for small farmers to have any agricultural technology, and there's a very big difference between engaging and not engaging in agricultural technology. Let me give you a specific example. How infertile is the land in China? We tested the soil in seven provinces. Organic matter in the soil is approximately 0.2%. The farm we purchased in Chile, the worst soil has 3% organic matter, and the best has 14%. The soil is already infertile enough in China, coupled with using fertilizer for long periods of time. So if you don't massively use agricultural technologies, then the agricultural products are going to be inferior in quality and in small amount. There is indeed profit margin here, which I'm not going to talk about. The other profit margin is branding. The Chinese people worry about everything they eat. You don't know whether what you eat is good or bad. So, we must seriously engage the industrial spirit and the manufacturing spirit when we conduct agribusiness. We must also utilize the legend spirit, that is, either don't do it, but if you do, give it your all in order to create a good brand. When people feel the food they eat is safe, then there is room to raise the price. These two margins allow us to be massively engaged in the agribusiness. Also, we've studied and found a way to collaborate with farmers. At the same time, we tested the way for 2 years, and we also studied a globalized arrangement. For example, if we grow high-end fruits or fruits in China, the production time only lasts a few months. But if you arrange for the fruits to be grown in the southern hemisphere, then the production time is all year round. We've considered serious of strategy. We will work hard in these areas. We'll also open up our financial services. For example, insurance companies, banks. We have two big investment companies. If there are success in good high-tech investment projects, then the holdings are going to purchase them to be our R&D projects. These are roughly our plans. Okay, thank you. I'm not going to talk about the listing issue. Maybe we'll be able to purchase legend baby formula in the future. Absolutely a possibility. Very good. This gentleman, please. Mr. Liu, how are you? I'm an adjunct professor at the Chinese University of Hong Kong. I would like to ask you a question related to Hong Kong. Recently, the Hong Kong government would like to make Hong Kong into an intellectual property education center. I would like to use the three acquisitions of Lenovo, two in IBM and one in Motorola. what kind of help is it going to have on China's manufacturing industry focused on intellectual property products and technology transfer products? Is this a good way to help the manufacturing industry to grow in the future? Because I feel that Chinese corporations are still very much in the low end. Since it's low end, can it be elevated? Otherwise, it's hard to develop their own technology. So, with your rich experiences, how much do you think is going to help the manufacturing industry of China in the future? Thank you. Chinese manufacturers going outside of China, the integration of the Chinese economy and the international economy is imperative. Why is that? For example, after the appreciation of RMB, when Chinese people go overseas, they see the prices of everything are cheap. You can see in Chile, as an example, the farm we purchased in Chile to rent a piece of land in China is 1200 RMB per acre per year. Land in Chile, the buyer price is 3000 RMB per acre. There is such a big discrepancy. Therefore, when we acquired IBM, what did we acquire? How did we complement each other? The brand, the technology, the international resources. What did we bring into the table? When IBM managed what we purchased, they lost money. When we managed, we have profits. Why? Because IBM later became a software system-based company. The profit margin is relatively higher. What does it mean by higher? Says, look, like it's okay for an employee working in the financial sector to wear a suit, but it's not for you to wear a suit and dress shoes to sell fried breadsticks. Manufacturing is detail-oriented. If water is a profit, then it's being accumulated one drop at a time, and you have to be conscientious at every single detail. You have to handle everything seriously to survive. Lenovo has conducted very thorough researches on these issues. So it's with such collaboration that we're successful. Then the market is actually an international market. In the future, the many areas that are Chinese markets. In the past, China was mainly an export country. If it's going to be consumption-oriented, then China is going to be a very large market too. China has funds and production capability, but what lacks is, for example, a good international brand, management capability, and technology, and so forth. How to make the connection? When it comes to connection, China has a major problem. Since Hong Kong has been an international city all these years, it might be easier for a British person, an American, and a Hong Kong person to work together than a British person, an American, and a person from mainland China. That's because China used to be a closed nation, and there were other reasons such as a different system, etc. Therefore, if Hong Kong can be a middleman, not only in intellectual property, but also in languages and habits and so forth, to make it as one, I think it will be very helpful to China. But this problem is so broad that not only does Mr. President of the university not be able to resolve, maybe political leaders should give it some thought. Hong Kong has educated so many good students. How can they serve Hong Kong, serve China, and serve the world? This is really a big topic. I believe that the Chinese University of Hong Kong must have, you could collaborate with universities. The students your school educated, where do they go afterwards? How can they be a bridge between the Chinese economy and international economy? This is really quite important. I had, let's not say university, but with some Chinese enterprises, like what I told you, and talked with people from Hong Kong about collaboration. We talk about collaborating for 3 years, but it never happens. Why? It's fast when the collaboration is between Chinese enterprises. There's not enough communication between people. When people are very familiar with each other, it's much more convenient to do DD, with relatively little contacts and misunderstandings happening. So, there must be exchanges between students, contacts among young people. This is really very good. Collaboration begins to happen, but the speed is still a bit slow. Okay, Donald. I'm Dong Tai Zhang. I want to ask you about Digital City. I just saw that there's a subsidiary under Legend Holdings, and it's called Digital China. Digital China is a pretty important player in promoting smart city in China. Legend originally did computer, and they collaborate with each other. Would you tell us your future strategic considerations? What does Legend Holdings think of smart city? Does it have a brilliant future, or how do you look at it?
Is
because Weiguo and Digital China, we have a relatively small shareholding at Digital China. So it's true that Weiguo does not communicate with me frequently, but I know a little bit about it. A smart city is very much needed in China. What does it need? When the Chinese government plans a city, it needs stable and long-term considerations. For example, Beijing. And in 5 years, how many people are there going to be in Beijing? With cloud computing, with large capacity computing, it can have a good statistical rules. Under these circumstances, what would be the best way to conserve energy, to design closest transportation routes, etc.? The deployment of all these are part of the smart city. But first is the government. Government leaders from one administration to another must be able to continue the mechanism. Only if that is done can the creation of a smart city be possible. Otherwise, each political leader has their own thoughts and has something new to the idea that makes the creation of a smart city very difficult. So this is really not a technical issue. Is an administrative system issue. It's okay to express opinions about the government, but please don't report it in the media. That's fine. There's no problem in Hong Kong. In other words, it's quite all right to make these comments with the current government. Mr. Liu, how are you? My name is Miao Xiao. I'm a second-year student at HKUST. You mentioned about the difficulties the Lenovo group faced since the beginning and handling strategies. I would like to ask you the greatest problem the Lenovo group currently has and the handling strategy. Thank you. Are you asking about the Lenovo group that manufactures computer, or are you asking about Legend Holdings? Did you ask about the Lenovo group? Yes, of course, challenges from the mobile internet products. The challenges are very severe because the Lenovo group has two development directions. One is a longitudinal development. For example, in mobile phones, the chips in the screen of a mobile phone and continue the path we're going. This is one way. Another way is to link with application service. This means to continue our computer business, and on top of it, to include like mobile games or the kind of business like Yunmao's. But you must choose one between the two and continue to do it in depth. Actually, these two both bring a lot of difficulties. Samsung of South Korea, the chips in their mobile phone screen has anti-shock function, and the profits are very high. But they invest in several billions of US dollars per year, and it has been going on for many years now. This is because the company leaders are persistent and dare to do so, and they might also have some support from the government. For the Lenovo group, it's only in recent years that the cash flow looks good, and that's the reason for loss of acquisitions. But how long can this last? So never let this happen. No change, no innovation means death. But when innovation happens, it equates to immediate death. This is really a great test to Yuan Jingyang. This gentleman, please. Respected Mr. Liu, respected President Chen, good afternoon. First, let me introduce myself. I apologize, I have a cold. I came from YoYo Software. It's Wenming Jing's, yes. And it's a very good company. Are you a student here? No, I'm an overseas UOPO business representative of the company. Our boss should be present here, but due to some other engagement, he couldn't be present. First, I must admit that Lenovo's success is something we should all learn from. As a very famous software manufacturer in China, YoYo, we're facing such a problem. We also face an international globalization problem. I would like to ask Mr. Chuanzhi Liu, as a Chinese enterprise that is going global, what kind of problems should be taken off first? For example, is it globalized personnel or globalized products or is it like a globalized market? In all these areas, which are the ones you think should be worth our consideration? Thank you very much. Before the acquisition, it's better to think carefully the objective of the acquisition. For example, after the acquisition, are you investing in a bigger international market, or are you going to have high profits in a certain region? You must think over the objective first, then think of the ways you can achieve your objective. For example, why must I go for the brand name at that time? Because we, Lenovo, we're number one in China. Banks in China and high-end departments all purchase Lenovo's products. And for regular people, they think they're purchasing IBM's. So branding to us is a must-have. That's why we were determined to make the purchase. When you want to go outside, you need to consider where you're going to, where should you go, and what you're after. After you're clear about the objective, then the rest will show up naturally. These are mainly my suggestions. Due to time, we now invite the last question. The person in the back, the gentleman in pink. Mr. Liu, how are you? Mr. President, how are you? My name is Fu Xin Zhou, and I came from Shenzhen. I'm a global business student at Hong Kong UST. I would like to ask Mr. Liu, in the past several decades, technology developments are very fast and companies have to pick their successor. I want to know, with many excellent employees at Legend and Lenovo, how did Mr. Liu pick Mr. Yuanxin Yang to be your successor? What kind of special characteristics does he have and you can share with us so that we can learn from it? Thank you.
There's one thing Legend has in China that enterprises recognized, and that is people. For example, in the agribusiness, after we've picked a good industry, my deciding factors are not the business or money, it's the people. If I feel that this person can act independently, then it works. Actually, at Lenovo, we keep training people to act independently. How to make the pick is when we get to a certain level, if the officer can remarkably complete the task. If a person can do what they say, then it will draw the attention of the relevant department. The relevant department that I mentioned here is not the Public Security Bureau. This is number one. After this, after continuous consideration, this person needs to have the chance to speak. This person must be able to explain why they can do a good job. If you can do a good job but not able to speak well, it's not going to work. The ability to speak is not a linguistic art. Rather, you're able to explain because there is a methodology at Lenovo called duplicable steps. This is in Wei Qi. You know Wei Qi? Yes, I do. Duplicable steps mean after the chess game is finished, you're able to, with eyes closed or open, able to repeat exactly what you did in the game and figure out what you did right and what you did wrong. This is how we do things at Legend Lenovo to go back and redo once more. After you win and you're able to repeat what you did, when you got lucky and what exactly did you do? this person will be even more noticeable. Then this person might be transferred to a position that has nothing to do with their other job. If after the transfer, the person still has very strong organizational skills, if this can be done several times with no problems, then this person probably has the ability to act independently. With the emergence of a person who can act independently, it's like opening up a wide horizon. After this person is recognized, then you have to step in attention to the qualities of this person. To understand this person's quality is what we'll say, look at the back of the brain. What does look at the back of the brain mean? For example, when a subordinate speaks to you and reports to you, he is very respectful and looks you in the eyes. The back of the brain is where he will not let you look at. This is something we need to pay attention to. How does he treat other people? Is this a person with integrity? How he treats his family. Understand this person from different angles. We don't only want a competent person. We also want someone who is ethical and at least has business integrity. Only this, that can we feel secured that this is indeed a person who can act independently. Let us give Mr. Liu a big thank you. Thank you, thank you. This is a little gift for you. This is the wall as you enter the university. These are inventions of the old days. No computer yet. Okay, thank you, thank you. It's been my pleasure.